For many, Frank Lloyd Wright is considered the face of American architecture. His techniques served as the avant-garde for thousands of designers after him, and still survive in many of his most famous buildings. Perhaps even more enduring than his iconic buildings is his life story, highlighted by his success, but underscored by tragedy, infidelity, and perseverance. If you guys enjoy the video, please remember to like and subscribe. Wright was born in Richland Center, Wisconsin, on June 8, 1867. Wright's childhood was chaotic. His father would leave the family when he was just 17, and he would never see him again. Thus, his mother and several other women would play an instrumental role in Wright's development into the man we know today. Around the age of 20, Wright moved to Chicago and eventually found a job as a draftsman at the prestigious firm of Adler & Sullivan. Under Sullivan's tutelage, Wright would become the firm's chief draftsman. Sullivan had a large impact on Wright's own theory about architecture. Most notable was Sullivan's condemnation of the spread of European styles into the United States. This was further inflamed by the Chicago World Fair in 1893. Dubbed the Columbian Exposition, the European Beaux-Arts style would capture many American minds, which would only strengthen Wright's conviction to create a style uniquely American. Wright was forced to leave Adler and Sullivan in the same year after secretly taking private side commissions to make ends meet at home. For Wright, this presented an opportunity to fully stretch out his design muscles. While Sullivan had specialized in office buildings, Wright preferred residences. For the next 16 years, the Oak Park neighborhood of Chicago would become his playground. While on his own, he would develop his iconic Prairie style. Named after the Great Plains, the design is intended to be distinctly American. Buildings hug the earth and mimic the landscape, with low, horizontal lines, no attic or basement, and rows of casement windows. On the inside, the plan was open, encouraging circulation between the public areas. What's more, Wright would often design every aspect of the building, including the interior finishes. Rugs, lamps, and even the windows all flowed as one from his mind, further strengthening the unity between the site, building, and inhabitant. The pinnacle of the Prairie style is often considered the Roby House. Unwaveringly monumental, the horizontality of the house is emphasized by cantilevered roofs reaching up to 20 feet. Sprawling nearly 150 feet, the rows of windows, strong lines, and Roman brick all nod to the Midwestern landscape. Opening in 1909, the open floor plan and warm interior culminated into what Wright called the most ideal place in the world. Additionally, at the request of Frederick Roby, the house was also designed to be private from outside viewers, offering relief from the busy Chicago streets. Across the United States today, ranch houses can be seen as distant relatives of the ideas born in the Prairie style. Wright would marry his first wife, Catherine Lee Tobin, in 1889, and soon fathered six children. But for all of Wright's early success as a residential designer, he disdained family life. Even uttering, "I hated the sound of the word papa," he was further burdened by the financial needs of his growing family. "Never one to skimp on decadence," Wright declared, "so long as we had the luxuries, the necessities could pretty well take care of themselves." In 1909, Wright would solve his family issues by abandoning his wife and children and eloping to Germany. With him was Martha Borthwick, the wife of a former client. Better known as Mema, she offered Wright solitude and intellectual support. While in Germany, Wright would author two publications of his own work, for the first time gaining international recognition. After 2 years abroad, and having been rejected by most social circles of Chicago, Wright and Mema settled near his childhood home in Wisconsin. It would be here where Wright would establish his lifelong architectural headquarters. Named Taliesin, the Prairie-style residence served as his home and studio, adorned with elements of nature including extensive gardens and an artificial lake. Although struggling to secure commissions, Wright did begin to settle into his new stage of life. He would work on some notable projects, such as Midway Gardens in Chicago, while Mema translated works of Swedish feminist Ellen Key. On August 15, 1914, while Wright was working in Chicago, tragedy struck Taliesin. Julian Carlton, a servant on the property, attacked Mema, her visiting children, and a few aides with a hatchet. After mauling them, he would douse Taliesin in gasoline and set it ablaze. In total, seven were killed, three of them children. Carlton swallowed hydrochloric acid and would never give a motive before dying 2 weeks later. Mema's death would deeply afflict Wright, whose career was already in question. He would briefly marry Miriam Noel, but the rocky relationship ended quickly. Then, for the next decade, Wright would be in and out of Taliesin as he tried to build his portfolio and reputation. He first stopped in Los Angeles to design the Hollyhock House, so called for his client's favorite flower. Traveling even further west, Wright's passion for art and architecture would be reinvigorated in Japan. His most notable work, the Imperial Hotel in Tokyo, was a massive undertaking. But like his other works, it incorporated elements of organic architecture, encouraged harmony in public and private spaces, and was furnished with elements designed by Wright himself. The hotel would survive numerous earthquakes and stand strong until it was demolished in 1967. In 1924, after returning to the United States, Wright met Olga Lazovich. 31 years his junior, the dancer from Montenegro soon moved in to Taliesin. Before they married in 1928, Wright would have his seventh child, a daughter, and Taliesin II would burn down due to a wire malfunction. Nevertheless, with Olga's stabilizing presence, he would once again rebuild Taliesin and refocus on his pursuit of mastering in American architecture. In the 1930s, the Great Depression was crippling America. After declaring bankruptcy, Wright and Olga needed new sources of income. Realizing they could host up to 36 students on their expansive property, Wright would teach and Olga would act as a den mother for a yearly tuition of $650. Thus, in 1932, the Taliesin Fellowship was born. Students would learn by getting hands-on experience designing and drafting real commissions, such as the Johnson Wax Building. Wright fostered a total learning environment. Along with architecture, students were instructed on how to cook, garden, dance, play music, and attend Sunday services. With the fellowship, Wright crafted the Usonian style, which offered affordable yet thoughtful homes. He saw the architect as having the responsibility of forging the American identity, one of a people united under democracy. This thesis would culminate in Broadacre City, his ambitious vision for the United States' future. Every family would have their own house and gardens, emphasizing the importance of the individual and family. On a macro scale, the country would be woven together by a network of highways, monorails, and even helicopters. Broadacre City was first shown off at Rockefeller Center in 1935. Wright knew that his ideas were largely impractical, but it did generate discussion on his view of the future, versus those of modernist architects like Johnson, Mies, and Le Corbusier. In another move to test new construction methods and design innovations, Wright and his fellowship founded, designed, and built Taliesin West in 1937. Located outside of Phoenix, it is largely reminiscent of his Prairie style. The location served as an alternative headquarters for the fellowship, offering them relief from the bitter Wisconsin winter. One student of the Taliesin Fellowship was Edgar Kaufman Jr. He would introduce Wright to his father, Edgar Kaufman Sr., who was looking to construct a vacation home outside of Pittsburgh. The Kaufmans' deep pockets and patience offered Wright the perfect opportunity to design something profound. Wright's ideas were nothing short of radical. The site, a creek called Bear Run, offered an abundance of natural surroundings. The defining feature of the site was a waterfall, on top of which Wright placed the house. Rebuffing the Kaufmans' initial objections to the design, the location offered direct access to the water and natural pools, with the soothing sounds of the stream permeating the house. The house is anchored by a central living area, crafted from local sandstone. The interior spaces are illuminated by large glass windows, inviting the user's gaze outside. Concrete trays cantilever out over the falls and into the forest, offering a subliminal harmony with the landscape. In 1938, before the building was even completed, drawings of the new house were featured in New York City and in Time magazine. Finally, at the age of 70, Wright would have his American masterpiece. After his accomplishments at Fallingwater, Wright was approached by wealthy art collector Solomon Guggenheim. In 1943, Wright accepted the challenge to incorporate his organic style into a new art museum in New York City. For the rest of his life, he would be challenged by budgets, codes, and artists while attempting to conceive of something extraordinary. His perseverance, even through his 80s and into his 90s, ultimately got his vision to come to life. But just 6 months before it opened, Frank Lloyd Wright would die peacefully at the age of 92. The Guggenheim Museum opened in October of 1959 and is often seen as his greatest and most influential work, an immortalization of his ideals in stone and concrete. Wright used his final years to push his designs as far as possible, both physically and theoretically. The design was undoubtedly influenced by another building that Wright was never able to construct, the Gordon Strong Planetarium. A continuous, gently sloping ramp displays the artwork as it spirals down to the lobby. The continuous path and lack of walls emphasize the relationship between the individual and the whole. Visitors can admire a single piece of artwork, but at any time see where they have already been and where they are headed next. His attention to the fluidity of the building's program created what Wright called a beautiful symphony such as never existed in the world of art before. Amongst his great achievements, Wright did have his shortcomings. Many of his projects would suffer due to poor construction. To him, it was paramount that the client and engineer conform to the idea of the architect. This has resulted in a litany of multi-million dollar renovations to many of his projects, including the Hollyhock House and Fallingwater. But to claim Wright failed as an architect because of construction deficiencies is outrageous. He is rather remembered for his broad use of new technologies and systems of design. He was considering passive heating and cooling in the 1920s, while American industrialism was still booming. His open plan approach and use of large atriums is now commonplace. In the end, he pioneered a style of architecture unlike anything else, something acutely American. The lofty ideals of America, from freedom to unity to exploration, were core tenets of his design philosophy. The habitats he would build sought to nourish the lives of the users, often by bringing humans closer to nature. He went to great lengths to design every aspect of a project to reinforce this idea of synchronicity. At the outset of his career, he would pen, "Good architecture should promote the democratic ideal of the highest possible expression of the individual as a unit, not inconsistent with a harmonious whole." Above all else, Wright was an American man. He believed that every person had the right to live a fulfilling life in the ideal circumstance. His story contained all the tropes of the American dream. He had affairs, hobbies, bad habits, and good qualities. He experienced loss, debt, and rejection, but ultimately success through sheer determination. To Frank Lloyd Wright, design was the most important aspect of his life, and he indeed produced some amazing designs. If you guys are interested in investigating this topic any further, I have listed my sources below. If you guys enjoyed the video, please remember to like and subscribe. It goes a long way in helping me build the channel. Thanks, and I'll see you guys in the next one.